Thank you, Ben. Thank you, everybody, for having me again, for inviting me to come back to DEF and to speak for a second year. I looked at the schedule for this weekend, and I saw a lot of really talented innovators who have done a lot of really great things who are going to talk to us. They're going to show us some examples and give us some lessons learned and help us all become better at reforming and innovating. I'm not here to do that kind of thing. Instead, I'm here to start us off, again, with something a little bit different. So last year, on the first day of DEF, we talked about Admiral William Sims and the gunnery revolution that he led about a century ago. And then in some of the breakout sessions, we talked about John Boyd. And we talked about the reform movements that he inspired. And we talked about the gun doctor. And we talked about 42nd Boyd. And we lauded the rebel innovator, the individual insurgent who overcame the bureaucracy and the system. We went to DEF X in Annapolis, and then at other forums over the past year, we've heard a mantra that started to pop up, that military organizations just can't innovate properly. They're not organized right. They're too top-down. They're too stovepipe. They're too bureaucratic. They just can't do it the way that Silicon Valley tells us it's supposed to be done. But what if I were to tell you it's not true, that military organizations actually do innovate? It's ahistorical to say that they don't. And so today I'd like to talk a little bit of an example of a military innovation that was actually driven by the bureaucracy. So in July of 1946, in the aftermath of the victory over the Axis powers, the United States military began what was called Operation Crossroads. And at a small South Pacific island called Bikini Atoll, we started setting off atomic bombs. We started testing what they did to military equipment and to military ideas. Now, the person who was sent to observe the Bikini test from the Marine Corps was Lieutenant General Roy Geiger. And Roy Geiger was an amphibious warrior par excellence, right? He had marched across the Pacific, and he had led troops at Guadalcanal, at Bougainville, at Guam. Then at Okinawa, he was placed in command of the entire 10th Army, all of the ground forces for the invasion. Kind of a big deal for a Marine. And so General Geiger watched the mushroom cloud rise over Bikini, and he saw the impact of that destructive power on the ships and the equipment that were at anchor in the lagoon. And while the Navy and the Air Force started getting excited about being able to deliver that destructive power and using their offset, if you would say, and the Army started to try and figure out how they would use atomic weapons themselves, Geiger saw something completely different. Instead, he saw a threat to the very fundamental nature of the Marine Corps. He saw a threat to the amphibious expertise that they had been developing for decades. He wrote a letter directly to the commandant with his observations. And in the letter, he said, "Since our probable future enemy will be in possession of this weapon, it is my opinion that a complete review and study of our concept of amphibious operations will have to be made. I cannot visualize another landing such as was executed at Normandy or Okinawa." Now, Commandant of the Marine Corps, Alexander Vandegrift, received the letter at HQ Marine Corps. And Vandegrift didn't need to be told that amphibious warfare had suddenly changed. Vandegrift had been awarded both the Navy Cross and the Medal of Honor for his leadership at Guadalcanal. He understood amphibious warfare. And he immediately acted. He established a board made up of three major generals in order to study the future of amphibious warfare. And it was led by General Lemuel Shepard. But as I think we can all kind of guess, you put a bunch of stars in a room together, and not necessarily a lot of work's going to get done when you lock the door. So Shepard brought on three staff officers, Colonel Ed Dyer, Colonel Bill Twining, and Lieutenant Colonel Sam Shaw. And these would make up the secretariat for the board. In actuality, these were the men who would do the work. They would actually write the report and then pass it up through the generals for their review and their comment. So they got down to work, and they started studying the different possibilities. And they quickly latched onto a very particular piece of technology, the helicopter. So at this point, the helicopter was a little bit less than a decade old, actually. The aircraft were quite small. They didn't have a lot of lift capability. They were slow. They really didn't meet any of the requirements that the Marine Corps had for solving their amphibious problem. But still, the Marines saw something here. And Ed Dyer began visiting Sikorsky Aircraft and Frank Piasecki and watching the demonstrations of the current aircraft and talking to the engineers about how the future field might develop. And he sat down with Igor Sikorsky himself, who told him that there was no issue here. The old Russian believed that with current technology, not future developments, not 10, 15 years down the line, but current methods, they could build helicopters that had the size and the speed that the Marine Corps needed. And Frank Piasecki, with his tandem rotor designs, was just as excited and just as optimistic. They started to wonder if maybe, just maybe, they had found the answer to what they called the amphibious prayer. So they started working, but it languished. It slowed, because there were other things they needed to study. One of the ideas was using massive submarines that would surface and land the landing force from a submarine. Another idea was to use giant seaplanes that would kind of serve as airborne LSTs. They'd land in the surf and then taxi right up onto the beach for the landing force. So as they studied these things, the project slowed. Until one day, a test pilot from Pax River took a Sikorsky Hoverfly helicopter, and he flew from Pax River up to Quantico to visit a friend of his for lunch. And Bill Twining and Ed Dyer stood in the window of their office and watched this Hoverfly come over Quantico and pull into a hover just outside their office. And a photographer actually snapped a quick picture of this as they watched some crazy Marine run out underneath this helicopter that was hovering, mind you, which today we all think of hovering helicopters, yeah, normal thing. This was revolutionary, right? A hovering aircraft is insane. And this nutty Marine jams his garrison cover down on his head, runs underneath it, grabs the horse collar, and he's hoisted 15 feet into the air and into the cabin before the aircraft flies off. And Ed Dyer turned to Bill Twining standing there in the window and said, "Hey, maybe it's time to stop fooling around." And that's a quote, stop fooling around. And they sat down and they wrote a report that told the Commandant of the Marine Corps that the helicopter was the future of amphibious assault and the future of the Marine Corps. So Vandegrift received the report after it went through the major generals that were on the board. And Vandegrift, within 3 days of receiving the report, had read it, endorsed it, and cut orders to start work. He was a true believer from day one. So his orders consisted of two parts. First, they needed to develop a doctrine for the employment of this new technology, this new weapon system. And second, they needed helicopters. So the second part was establishing the Marine Corps' very first helicopter squadron. So Marine Corps Helicopter Squadron 1, or HMX-1 as it was designated, was placed under the command of Ed Dyer. And he immediately went up to Connecticut to Sikorsky Aircraft to qualify as a helicopter pilot. But he was going to need people. He was going to need Marines in this squadron. So the NCOs and the enlisted Marines would be a relatively simple task. He could tap into Marine Corps aviation and get the talent he needed for his mechanics and for his administrative support. But the officers were going to be kind of a different story. If this crazy idea in this new squadron was going to work, he needed a very particular kind of leadership. So in the spring of 1947, Colonel Ed Dyer walked into an auditorium at Marine Corps schools in Quantico. And in the auditorium were about 60 Marines, mostly captains and first lieutenants, that made up the junior PME course there at Quantico. And Dyer started a brief. And he talked about the helicopter, and he had diagrams of what helicopters looked like, and he had charts that showed their performance characteristics, and he talked about what they thought they could do. And then he offered these junior officers the opportunity to join his new unit. At the end of his pitch, he said to the audience, "Now, there's a large body of opinion in the Marine Corps that figures that helicopters aren't going anyplace. So if you're interested, stay here, and I'll get your names. If not, don't waste your time or mine. Just shove off right now." Over 40 of the Marines in the room stood up, turned their back on the colonel, and walked out. Of the ones that stayed behind, a few would wash out over the next year of flight training. But the JOs that stayed behind and accepted Dyer's challenge would become the ready room that brought the Marine Corps into the helicopter age. So HMX-1 was formally established in December of 1947. With Colonel Ed Dyer in command, 6 pilots, 3 Marines, and no aircraft. Now, there were more pilots coming. They were in the flight training syllabus. And the commandant kept the pressure on the bureaucracy, and Marines started to trickle in as the maintainers and as the administrative support. Commandant also kept the pressure on the Navy, because the Navy was responsible for buying these helicopters. And by February, HMX-1 had 5 HO-3S-1 helicopters, dragonflies. They started flying as much as they could. They tested everything they could think of, from logistics support missions to medevacs to observation to reconnaissance missions. So the other part of the orders that the commandant had cut was the development of the doctrine. And this was assigned to Marine Corps schools, which was the PME institution at Quantico. The Helicopter and Seaplane Transport Board was established at Marine Corps schools, just down the street from where this new squadron had been hangared. And it was put under the supervision of Colonel Robert Hogaboom. Now, Hogaboom was the director of the senior course, the senior PME course there at Quantico. And he had a lot of responsibilities. He had to make sure that the curriculum was being taught properly. He had to monitor all the different programs that were being run. And as he divided his time, the actual leadership of this board fell mostly to his assistant director, a Marine known as Brute. Lieutenant Colonel Victor Krulak had been known as Brute since his days at the Naval Academy. He was a small man. Both his friends and his foes alike called him this. And Krulak had a reputation already. He was a bit of a rebel in the Marine Corps and already a bit of an innovator. In the 1930s, when he was a lieutenant stationed in China, he had written the first intelligence reports on Japanese landing craft. This is pre-World War II. He's the one who wrote the reports and actually built a model of a landing craft with a bow ramp that would drop so the troops could easily get onto the beach. And this is what led, eventually, to the Marine Corps' development of the Higgins boat. The Higgins boat, which arguably, technologically, is part of what made World War II possible for the United States of America. Krulak, during World War II, had won the Navy Cross, or been awarded the Navy Cross, for his leadership of a parachute battalion that conducted raiding operations in the Pacific. Krulak was also that crazy Marine who had run out underneath the helicopter in order to go to lunch with his buddy. Krulak wrote, "The evolution of a set of principles governing the helicopter employment cannot wait for the perfection of the craft itself, but must run concurrently with that development." So, HMX-1 was flying their aircraft. The pilots were starting to figure out how to handle them and what they could do. And Krulak and the officers that he had sprung from class in the senior course to work on this special board got to work developing their doctrine. Krulak and Dyer would get together, and they'd share the things that they were learning, what worked and what didn't. So eventually, they sat down and they wrote a doctrine. Because Krulak invited HMX-1 to participate in Operation Packard 2, which was the end-of-year exercise that Marine Corps schools would do. It was a command post exercise. And so Marines need instructions, and they need manuals. So they had to write something to tell everybody how to do this helicopter thing. So they sat down and wrote a document that was called Amphibious Operations, Employment of Helicopters, Tentative. It became known as FIB 31 because it was the 31st manual in this series. FIB 31 introduced the ideas of vertical envelopment and air assault to the world. It was the very first doctrine that talked about these things. And so Krulak wrote later, "We had so little to go on, no data, only conviction." So they gave this document to HMX-1, and HMX-1 flew out to the USS Palau in Onslow Bay off North Carolina. And they began their exercise. Over the course of the day-long exercise, they flew 35 missions from ship to shore. They completely bypassed the defenses that were set up on the beach to stop them. They went straight to their objectives. They inserted 66 combat-loaded Marines to secure the landing zones, and then spent the rest of the day flying logistics missions that brought in the command element for the regimental combat team, regimental command team. Now, they tried to keep expectations low, but even with these little Sikorsky helicopters that could hardly lift three Marines, this was seen as an enormous success. They actually had found the answer to the amphibious prayer. So this was just the start. 46, 47, 48, just the start. And the Marines began developing this virtuous cycle where they would break off groups at Marine Corps schools that would study the ideas and develop the theory behind the doctrines. And then they'd give it to HMX-1, which would fly aircraft and test things out, make sure the technology worked. And then they'd go do exercises where they'd test their new ideas. Sometimes they succeeded, sometimes they failed. And then they'd send them back to the groups working the special projects to hone and refine the system. Now, the Marine Corps development of the helicopter was interrupted in June of 1950, when North Korea invaded South Korea. And by all accounts, the Marine Corps should stop, right? We had just fought and won the biggest war the world had ever seen. We know how to fight wars. Let's just go do it again. But no, they didn't. Instead, they doubled down on this crazy new idea of the helicopter. Four aircraft, their maintenance crews, and their pilots were broken off, and they were attached to Marine Observation Squadron 6. And VMO-6 deployed to Korea. In August, they arrived as the Provisional Brigade was arriving, and they began flying missions along the perimeter at Pusan. They flew everything, medevac, command and control missions, reconnaissance missions, resupply, bringing food, water, ammo, everywhere along the lines. Korea became the proving ground for the helicopter, not just for the Marine Corps, but for all the military services. So, if this is true, and the Marine Corps found the answer to the amphibious prayer, and they did it by using the system that they already had, what can we learn from this? What are the observations that we can take away? There's Korea. So the first lesson is leadership. Having the individual with the good idea is not enough. It doesn't even get us close. You need senior leaders who can recognize a problem and are willing to act despite the risks involved. You need senior leaders who understand that if you're not innovating, you're not improving. And if you're not improving, you're probably falling behind the enemy. You need the Geigers and you need the Vandegrifts. But you also need staff officers. You need those officers that can make the bureaucracy work in the service of the good idea. You need experienced leaders who know how to make the bureaucracy function, but also know when and how they need to maneuver around the bureaucracy. You need the Krulaks, and you need the Dyers. And finally, you need the junior officers. You need the ones that are willing to take a gamble on this crazy new idea in this crazy new unit. You need the guys who stuck around when they were offered the opportunity to shove off. You need the Captain Paul Flynn's and Lieutenant Robert Longstaff's, the very first two pilots that qualified as helicopter pilots with HMX-1. So today, are we training our officers and our NCOs and senior enlisted to be these kinds of leaders? Do we have a personnel system or a promotion system that encourages these kinds of leaders and develops them and helps make sure we get the right people in the right jobs? The second observed lesson that I have from this is organization. Quantico and the flexibility of the commands at Quantico made the development of helicopter doctrine possible. Did it matter that the members of the PME classes did not finish the core curriculum? No, it did not. Nobody's career was negatively impacted because they worked on a special project and didn't get the administrative checks in the block. And then the exercises. These exercises were designed to test new ideas, to do new things, even to fail. What are our exercises designed for today? These weren't pre-deployment exercises, right? These weren't certification events. These weren't workups, okay? But today, what are we focused on? Are we focused on new ideas and trying the innovative idea, the next generation thing? Or are we focused on making sure that the readiness matrix is built properly in the computer system and the admin is done smoothly and the checklists are run right so that we get the right grades from the evaluators? So I don't know the answers, but these are some of the questions that we need to be asking ourselves. So last year I talked about the difference between lessons learned and lessons observed. And I will freely admit that these two lessons, leadership and organizations, adaptive leadership, adaptive organizations, they're not particularly new ideas. We hear about them all the time. But they're here. They're in this history. So what can we do about it? And that's my charge to us here at DEF 2.0 and to those who might watch on the computer. You need to be the adaptive leaders. You need to be the ones that reform the organizations from the inside to make things possible. Now, we talked about the gun doctor, and we talk about 42nd Boyd, and they are wonderful historical examples for us of overcoming the bureaucracy. But today, what do we need? That's not what we need. Today, what we need is adaptive leaders who are willing to take on their organizations from the inside, who are willing to reform them, and are willing to make our need for those insurgents not exist anymore. We need to make the gun doctor and Boyd unnecessary. Thank you. And so I tried to filibuster and fill the entire time, so I don't know how much room there is for questions.
We have about 10 minutes for questions, so a couple guys will be floating around with microphones. Do you have anything to ask?
I don't know if we're supposed to stand up or say who we are, but I'm just used to that from all the military briefings I've been in. As I listened to your talk today, it was interesting to see innovation in the Marine Corps post-World War II. And do you see any sort of parallels between that and how the Germans innovated using using mechanized warfare during the interwar periods?
I think at a 50,000-foot view, there is, right? Because it's the whole idea of how do we make the system actually produce these sorts of changes, right? The buzzword used to be these transformations. Today, our buzzword is innovations. So surely. The Marine Corps, this was not necessarily something new for the Marine Corps, and I think this is worth mentioning, right? During the interwar years, Marine Corps schools invented amphibious warfare, right? What we know is amphibious warfare today didn't exist until the interwar years, when they started writing the Advanced Base Defense Manual and their manuals for amphibious assault, the same time they wrote the Small Wars Manual. And they did it in a very similar way by breaking off special groups at Marine Corps schools to write those manuals and work on those projects. So these Marines, and I think that's an important point, these Marines weren't coming up with something new. They were using the system that they knew that they had.
BJ, thanks. I will say who I am. I'm Jim Hasick. I'm from the University of Texas and from the Atlanta Council. So I heard your talk last year on SIMS, and I think that's a counterexample to what I'm just going to ask, but I'm going to riff off the point about the Germans, that it has been suggested that a large part of what drove German military innovation in the interwar years or, Prussian innovation, say, around 1807, 1808, prior to the final campaigns against Napoleon, was that existential event. Getting your butt kicked severely means you need to stop doing what you were doing before and start doing something new. How much of, having looked at the history, how much of the Marine Corps' innovation there in the late 40s do you think was driven by the existential threat to the service? I mean, certainly, not just Harry Truman, there were other people who were wondering at the time whether or not the Marine Corps, whether or not there was a point to the Marine Corps. People wonder about this a lot. So I think the mechanism makes a lot of sense for, I think you traced the story well, but does it work without that stimulus? What do you think?
So arguably, the existential threat, the political existential threat to the Marine Corps that was the post-World War II years, was not necessarily helped by deciding to redefine your service on a crazy new technology that's unproven, right? I mean, we all look back on it, it's like, yeah, obviously, that was what they needed to do, and it proved out, and they revolutionized themselves, and they showed how important they were. Dyer wasn't kidding when he told those JOs that the majority of the Marine Corps thought this was nuts. And those 40 JOs that got up and left kind of prove it. Okay, so I don't know that the political existential threat to the Marine Corps during that period, which Krulak actually ends up being a significant part of by starting the Chowder Society and whatnot, I don't know that that necessarily plays into the driver behind this. Like I said, we had just won the war, right? We just won World War II. Our methods had been proven out. The Marine Corps doesn't need, in conventional wisdom, to go find a new way to do their job. They just beat the snot out of Japan. So I'm not really sure that the motivation was quite as stark as your question makes it sound. There are lots of what-ifs, and there are lots of things that impact the decisions that get made in history. And I think that's one of the important insights to studying history, right? Mark Twain's reputed, never really sourced quote that history doesn't repeat itself, but it certainly does rhyme. The same events are not going to happen again. We cannot study history to say, I will do X, Y, Z because that's what worked exactly before. We can study history in order to help ourselves ask the right questions to address our problems today.
Good morning. So we're looking backwards through the lens of history at the one idea that was successful and did work and was adopted. What were the other ideas that weren't adopted? And were they, did they fail because they weren't good ideas or because the people who were proposing them weren't part of the inner circle?
So kind of the big three when it comes to the amphibious issue were the ones that I listed, right? The helicopter, using submarines, and seaplanes. And the seaplanes part of it is actually an interesting parallel. In the same time period, there was a significant fight going on in the Coast Guard between this birth of helicopter aviation for rescue and the established seaplane pilots that had done rescue for a generation. And so it's kind of mirrored there a little bit in the Marine Corps, this idea that the seaplanes, hey, we build them bigger. The problem ends up being that all of the technologies looked like they kind of weren't there yet. And I think that when it came to the submarine question, it was just a bridge too far for the Marines to envision themselves underwater for long periods of time. I think the fact that the seaplane made it as far as it did into the Hogaboom Board's title, the Helicopter and Seaplane Transport Board, shows that that was still a serious consideration. And it was that research and that study of going and talking to the folks that design these types of aircraft and seeing the possibilities that the helicopter really did provide. The other thing, if you think about it, is both the seaplane and the submarine are a surface assault over the beach still. The helicopter skips the beach. The Marine Corps is having a debate today about its future, and the Marine Corps is having a discussion. And one of the things you see in the defense press all the time is, how can they talk about amphibious assault? You'll never see another Normandy again. Geiger said that in 1946, guys. The Marine Corps has known that for a generation now, two generations in military terms. So I think that it was that ability to move across the beach that made the helicopter the fundamental answer for them.
Good morning, Scott Cleveland. I'm involved with the F-35 on the Navy side, and there's a direct parallel with the Marine Corps and what they were doing with amphibious warfare and how they're treating their F-35 tactics that the Navy is not doing. They're bucking the system. They're extremely nimble. They are willing to take people off their career path in order, you know, to sustain and to develop their tactics for the F-35. And as the minority partner in the country with the Air Force, Marine Corps, Navy, they're driving the show. What is it specifically about the Marine Corps that allows them to do this? I would argue right now with the F-35 in particular, it is somewhat political. It's a discussion for a different time. But what is it about the Marine Corps that allows them to be so nimble and able to pivot so easily?
So I'm not sure that I'm the expert with the answer to that question. From the books I've read from guys like Dave Ulbrich, who wrote about in his book Preparing for Victory, or other folks that have written about the Marine Corps and the culture of the Marine Corps. Size probably has a certain part to play in it, right? They are the smallest of the services. And so it's easier to know who the right people are to put in the right places. The massive size of our bureaucracies today when it comes to personnel control, when I ask the question, do we put the right people in the right jobs? When you have as big a service as all of our services are, there is a big data problem that goes along with that, admittedly, right? So the Marine Corps might have a little bit of benefit there. I do think that they tend to look at their heritage, which is different than history. They look at their heritage differently than some of the other services do, potentially. And so they look back at the interwar years and the development of amphibious doctrine, and every Marine gets taught that, you know, at boot camp, almost. So, that goes throughout their PME courses. So the idea of innovation and changing things is something that they culturally talk about as their heritage. That's not necessarily something that the Navy or the Air Force in particular seem to do. We seem to be much more focused on the future, focused on the far horizon, which can be important and a very good thing, right? So it's a matter of finding the right balance.
All right.
Thank you, guys.